together. So again, it's a pleasure to be here, and we are very excited because for the first time here in Brazil, I have with me a student directing the scenes, because all the past times we had this project, I couldn't find any director student to direct the scenes. And so now for the first time, we have a directing student directing two scenes. And I hope that next year I will not direct any scene, just students will direct the scenes. We have a hard time finding directing students. And at the same time, we are very happy because Mason allowed us, so 1001 Plays allowed us to have not only regular students, so applying for this project, but also students from our extension project. That means activities we develop outside the university with different communities. And this time we have two representative playwright students from a workshop we gave to an institution at the university that offers activities for people above 50 years old. So this time we have two playwrights from this age. And I think this is so rich for this project to have these different life perspectives. So that's it. I think we can start then, Nick, with our readings, and I hope you enjoy them.
Perfect. I will bring that up in just a moment. I am troubleshooting the video as we speak. I understand the video is playing, but no audio. Give me 1 second. Sorry for the delay. I'm going to restart the share. I'm going to ask for someone to... Are we hearing this now?
Yes, yes.
Thank you. I will restart and get out of the way. Thank you so much.
Honey, let's go to bed, you little monkey.
Why can't I just play with you and mom till the morning?
My silly role, mom is tired. She had a really hard day at work today. And if you sleep now, we will play tomorrow.
No, I want to play now.
Okay, fine. How about a story?
A bedtime story?
Yes, I will tell you a bedtime story if you promise to go to sleep.
I promise.
Okay, here's how the story goes. There once was a girl named Rowan. a girl with her own ambitions, a young heart full of compassion. But she sees in her own reflections a heroine and a villain, a little girl with dangerous vision. She feels powerful emotions, filled into madness, but never vengeance. Where are you going?
Dad, I'm just going to school. It's Wednesday.
What time are you gonna be home?
Right after school at 3 p.m.
You promise?
I promise. Breakfast is in the fridge. I'll be home before you know it. Bye, Dad. I love you.
Hurt him, kill him, murder him.
Oh God, stop it, please. I have to go. Hey, we have 20 minutes. The bird isn't gonna cut itself.
This is disgusting. I can't touch this animal. She needs a proper resting place.
Give me your chicken. I'll do it.
No, do not touch this bean.
Jeez. Okay. Well, this is our exam. So you need to come up with a good reason not to do it.
I don't care if I get an F. I can't do this to this hen. She had a life before this. We need to have a proper burial and a cleansing ritual.
Well, how are you smuggling this whole chicken past Mrs. Wilder's?
You see that storage room? She never locks it. I will put the chicken in those for your prayers and wrap home thing in saran wrap. I can stuff it in my bag. We just need to somehow distract Mrs. Wilders so that I can grab the supplies from the storage room. Once I'm out, I'll wave at you through the glass window.
Wow, when did you have time to plan all this?
I didn't just stare at the chicken all class. Oh, what's scamming? Do you want to help me distract Mrs. W?
Sure. Hi, Mrs. Wilders. So, for the fifth step, would you recommend boning the thigh first or the breast first?
Yes, did it.
Hey, I didn't expect to see you here. What are you still doing with that bird?
I was waiting for you. I never got your name. I'm Ro.
I'm Rowan.
I'm about to bury this bean. Want to come with?
It's getting late. I have to come home to my dad right after school.
What? Are you scared?
It's not like that. My dad is sick and he needs me to take care of him.
Oh, you should go there. My father gets really mad when I don't listen to him. So I get it. I just don't know where to go.
Well, I know a spot. I can lead you there, but I have to leave right after.
That's awesome. Where?
Down by the river. I can show you.
Okay, let's go. This will be her thunderstorms. We need a date and a name.
Well, we can put today's date, September 20th, 2016. What should her name be?
About River.
That's a good name.
R.I.P. Miss Riverham. September 20th, 2016.
Fuck! Today is September 20th. I have to go now.
What's up with September 20th?
It's just I have to leave.
Hey, you can tell me. I'm your friend, remember?
My mom left 10 years ago today.
Oh, God. I'm so sorry.
We woke up one day and she was gone. She didn't even take her clothes or her stuff. All she left was a note. I couldn't read at the time, but Dad told me she was just going on vacation. She's never been home ever since. Sorry, I don't know why I'm telling you this.
Oh, it's okay. We're friends now. You can tell me anything.
Push her in. Just a little push. Watch her drown.
I'm sorry. I have to go.
What happened there?
Nothing happened.
You were somewhere just now. Where did you go?
I have to go. I'll see you at school tomorrow. Bye. What are you doing here?
Just checking on River. See if any animals got to her. What about you?
Just getting some air. Didn't see you in class this week. Is everything okay?
Yeah, everything's fine. It's just my father. He's sick too. It's the kind of sick where no matter how many drugs you take, the pain persists. And when he's in pain, he tends to talk very loud and throw stuff around and sometimes... If you could go to any place in the world, where would you go?
Probably India.
Why?
My mom's there, or at least I like to think so. The day she left a postcard from India with a note. Dad used it to say whenever we saved up enough money, we could both fly to India and visit mom. What about you?
I never knew my mom. It's always been my father and me. He was in the military, so we traveled a lot. I was in India once, when I was three those, so I can't remember anything. Anywhere you go, you tell yourself, it's gonna be different there. But it's not. The culture and the language change, but the loneliness stays with you. you did that again. Where did you go?
I'm sorry, I can't tell you.
Why not?
Because you'd leave if you knew.
Knew what?
That I am a monster. I have visions of doing really, really bad things to the people I love.
Like what?
Like killing them.
What?
I have visions of me killing everyone I ever love, strangling them, drowning them, stabbing them. It's so bad, I've never told anyone this. Sometimes the voice gets so loud, it's hard for me to know what is real and what is not. I have never acted on those thoughts, but they are in my head all the time. Strangle him. Just a little push. Push her in. Finish him. Push her in. Kill them all. Nothing matters anymore.
Is speaking right now?
Yes.
What are they saying?
What are they saying? They are telling me to push you in the river. Watch you drown.
Oh God! You are a monster!
No, please don't! I would never hurt you. That was just the voices. They are evil, but I am not. You know me. We are friends.
Please don't touch me. I can't believe I ever thought I could have a normal friend. I'd rather be alone than be with someone crazy.
Lou, I'm sorry I ever scared you. Step back
before I call the cops.
Where were you?
Dad, I didn't know you were still up.
Where did you go?
I was at the library. I had to study.
Don't fucking lie to me. Where the fuck did you go?
Dad, please. I was just taking a little walk. I was gonna come back in an hour.
It's midnight. You were gonna leave. Just like your mother. I was never going to see you again.
Dad, you just had too much to drink.
Too much to drink? I will show you too much to drink. My silly role, where did you go? Come and give me, Dad, a big old hug. I just want our family together. I didn't mean to scare you. I see you, silly Roe. You are playing hide and seek with me.
I'm sorry, Dad. Please forgive me. I'll call the ambulance. I'll go get help. Please, Dad, don't give up on me.
Get him! Kill him! It's serving more! Finish him! Watch him beg for mercy! Nothing matters anymore!
Stop, you demons! Stop it! It was an accident. I didn't mean to.
We are an extension of your brain.
It's not just us! It's you!
No! Lies! I've always tried to do the right thing and you are all telling me to kill!
Silly girl, we are a part of you. You wanted to kill him. So now, finish what you started.
No, I never want to hurt anyone. Get away from me! I need to wash this off me. It's so sticky and bloody. Why was there so much blood?
You just basically ripped his heart open.
So stop! I don't want to hear it. I never mean to hurt him. I never mean to hurt anyone. I just want everyone to be happy. I just want to do the right thing. God, please forgive me. Why can't I be a good person? Why am I in so much pain all the time? Why doesn't anyone love me? Is it because I'm a bad person? I'm evil. I'm a harm to society. The world doesn't need another monster like me. I drive everyone away. I drive my mother away. I drive Lou away. And now my dad is gone and it's my fault. Once again, we love you.
The world loves you. Can't you see that?
No, the world will be better without me. This river, it flows right out to the ocean, where all my sins will be washed away. That's the only place I'll be forgiven.
You're gonna drown if you blow.
She's already gone.
For you. Now we can play together.
Play together?
Yes, Dad is busy again, and Mom is still on vacation. Come, join me.
What do you have in your hand?
I found this in Dad's night drawer. I don't know what it says. I just know it's a postcard from Mom. Can you read it?
Dear, my dearest daughter, the love of my life, the light of my existence, I'm sorry for missing your birthdays. I'm sorry for causing you pain. I'm sorry for being weak. I'm sorry I couldn't be the mother you need. Take care of your father. He too is suffering. Though I hope you'll never find me, I pray that one day you'll find peace.
I'm really not into birthday cakes. I'm really not into birthdays.
I ate 4 birthday cakes last year. This is the first time you celebrate my birthday with me. I had too much of this crazy thing.
Oh, have you finished it?
Not so tasty. I don't think it's fresh. Some cakes taste just like a plastic cake model. It tastes cheap.
I said I'm not into cakes.
Mm. I need water. It's too greasy.
It's a mess. There's only beer.
Ugh, beer makes me nauseous. I'm going to the kitchen to grab some water.
Okay. The water is unboiled, the cups are in the cupboard, and look for them yourself.
Forget them. The best cake I'd had this year is the one I had in Shanghai with sister. We bought it from Kaiser and its cream was very, very tender.
You already told me this.
Hmm?
You said you wanted to spend another birthday with me.
I called you and then made her sad.
Are we going to finish it?
To be honest, I had enough.
Let's go inside now.
But I don't want to leave the cake till tomorrow.
We have a fridge here. You can have it to the breakfast.
That will make it taste more like a plastic model. A very expensive one. He drove to another city to buy it. It tastes pretty average, however.
You've told that story.
It's just records to me. This cake tastes a bit similar.
That's good humor. You want me to wait here till you finish your cake?
You feel like going inside your room now?
Yeah.
There you go then.
Forget it. I want to stay here with you.
I regret. I shouldn't have bought this cake.
I told you, I really hate birthday cakes.
I like the atmosphere of a birthday. A birthday, it always takes me. You can expect some sweet things to happen. Something you've been longing for.
Well, happy birthday to you.
Thanks.
Can we go inside now?
I'd like to sit for a while longer. I'm feeling a bit full and I need more time to digest.
How much is a Kaiser?
What?
You're taking Shanghai?
No more than 200 RMB.
So it doesn't taste like a plastic model, does it? I'm very curious.
I feel like throwing up now.
Actually, it has been 2 days since your real 18th birthday.
I've eaten 3 birthday cakes already this year.
One with your parents.
And today with you.
Why don't you like that?
That's not interesting. Will you sing me a birthday song?
No.
Because you don't like birthdays.
But you insist on eating a birthday cake, even though it is like a plastic model, because you're a little girl.
I regret. Eating cake at night makes me want to vomit. Seen those heart-shaped candles? They are the quivering type now. When you light them, they burn in a circle like fireworks.
I really don't know much about this.
But they smell when they are lit.
That's quite disgusting.
True. I feel like throwing up.
Seems that I forgot to say happy birthday.
You've already said it.
Well, have you finished eating?
I feel like throwing up.
Are you tired? You want some rest now?
I have no idea. That night, sister sang me a song. She is a dark star. And it was just like this.
What?
It was dark, just like this.
Put the cake in the fridge. I'll throw it away and we will go to my room.
This is killing me mood.
What?
You eating birthday cakes like this?
Oh, sorry. I didn't mean to spoil your fun. But I really dislike birthday cakes.
I know. But my intention was that we could celebrate your birthday together.
Thank you.
Why you say thank you? I was the one who called you and I was a Shanghai.
Hey, you got it wrong. I was the one who called you to say happy birthday.
I talked to you for a long time in the living room, and then sister went to take a shower. She played She is a Dark Star in the bedroom, and actually then I sensed something was wrong. Something I've been looking for a long time.
I'm very sorry. It seems like Seems that I shouldn't have made that phony call. It wasn't a surprise, was it?
Why don't you get back to your room first?
Well, remember to turn it off before you come in. It's been bumpy and crashing all night long. And how about this? You cut off a piece of cake for me, the largest one, the largest piece. After finishing the cake, we'll go inside. It has lasted way too long.
I better finish the cake myself. I don't want to leave until tomorrow.
Throw it away.
I can't finish.
You want to throw up, don't you?
I'm already nauseous anyway.
Okay. Happy 18th birthday.
You are leaving.
Ah, yeah.
You don't care then.
What? No, I do, but it's a good thing. And I know it's a good thing, so it's pointless to feel bad. I don't want to feel bad when you know I'm lucky to be leaving. Like in the grand scheme of things and all.
You are absolutely right. That's good. It's good that you are figuring that out by now.
Figuring what out?
Well, cause you know you have your struggles and all, and your mother and I, we get it and all. We can coddle you for a while when you were a kid, but that's all. Over, really. You are about to enter the real world. So you were right to figure out you have run out of time to feel sorry for yourself. Plata. Plata, plata, that's what it all becomes about. It won't be long till you face situations where there is no way for nobody to get hurt. There is no right answer. And you still have to choose. Bring food to the table. Get a job you don't deserve. Keep your head down and nod. Save yourself. Sometimes you gotta let people get hurt to get ahead, and that's just the way it goes.
I don't agree with you on that one.
You will.
If you say so.
You are gonna get stronger, and I hope you don't ever miss me. It's not the same, but I wasted so much time feeling sadness over my mom's death. I wasted so much of my life. At the end of the day, you just have to keep moving. You know, there's people out there who, to this day, even years after the company tanked, they thank me. They remember me. Because I was always smart. I was always fair. I never let, poor me, influence my thinking. And because of that, they trusted me and followed me and saw me as, they still say to me to this day, Vicente, you are my boss for all I care. You are the only real leader I've ever known. I know I've been tough on you, but I have seen you. There is a reason you are doing this. You out of all of us, leaving this godforsaken country for something better. It's a big challenge, and I don't know if even I would have the balls for that, but you are doing it, and I'm telling you, I have seen you, and you are not a fucking idiot like these other kids. Sometimes you are lazy, but you don't get distracted with bullshit. You don't cry for months over some boy or girl, or and you are going to have it all. I'm not a fucking idiot. You are my life's investment. And your fucking tuition, thousands are going to be worth it. And I know that about you. And that is my reward for all these years. Knowing you are living to go farther than I ever did. Go take Canada by storm.
Everyone. For those who don't know me, it's kind of weird that you're here, to be honest, if you don't even know me, but whatever. For those who don't know me, I'm Vincent's eldest daughter. That pretty much concludes the part of his odology in feeling good about. I don't know. What the point of saying anything? I get that this isn't for me and it isn't for you and for him, I guess. But it kind of feels like it should a little be for me. For closure, and there's a shit that I need. Sorry, stuff that I need to make peace with before he's in the ground. And none of it is all any of your business, but as previously stated, this simply has to be a teeny little bit for me. I don't even think most of you like me. I mean, I get that you have to love me because we are related, but I really don't think you like me, right? So I don't think this is ruining a moment for any of you. I think I'm going to say my piece whether you like it or not, and then I'll go back to the plane and we go back to our only form of contact being birthday greetings on Facebook. I'm truly, earnestly okay with that, okay? Anyway, okay, this isn't, I don't know, I had better moments, better memories, but this is what I have. In my whole life, my dad told me he loved me twice. The first one was only where he wasn't absolutely shit-faced. I know most of you knew of the smoking that killed him, but his drinking was quieter. And he didn't hate drinking, but he tried to quit smoking for years, decades. This one time I asked why he would think of me smoking, and he said, I should slap you square in the face. And he meant it. Kind of funny if you think about it. Little row of paper beating a grown man. But yeah, the drinking he felt in control of, even after almost drawing in the bathtub or after. Okay, yes. So the first time he'd only had like a beer or two. It was my birthday, and he was being so nice to me. We were talking about something. I can't remember when he took a sip of what I was drinking, and he went like, I could tell he wanted to laugh. It felt so bad. He was actually so worried. It was kind of injuring. I was like 17, so I could still drink. Me and my friends used to mix all the hard liquors in a huge glass of ice. During those nights, that last till like 7 in the morning, and landing this quite wise and all-knowing kind of drunk. It's a feeling that's really hard to stop chasing. I guess I thought he would recognize it. Anyway, he asked me why I drink like that, and I didn't know what to say. Why I drink like you? I remember thinking that. But I said nothing. And then he hugged me with one arm and patted my head with his other hand and said, let me get you a drink that it isn't poison. Then he kissed me my head and said, I love you, into my hair. The second time was the night before I moved away. He drank and drank and drank. He approached me when everybody left and asked me if I care what he thought about me. I said that I had to because he's my dad. He chuckled, then thought for a sec, then said he was proud of me. But he went shaking his head. I am sorry, but your mom and I had to work our asses off from way younger than you and had way less. You are still not doing half as much, not enough, but you because you are my life's investment and I'm not a fucking idiot. Your teaching, tens of thousands are going to be worth it. And I know that about you. That is my reward for all these years, knowing you are living to go farther than I ever did. And I started tearing up and he said, don't cry. Listen. He put his head on my shoulders and pointed at me with his index finger, stabbing me with in the center of my chest to emphasize his point. He said, everything I am, everything I will ever be, it's right here. You are everything I wanted my son to be. And then he told me he loved me. And we never spoke it again. So we spent a couple of decades glaring at each other from across a gap, knowing neither had the tools to build a bridge. And now it's over and neither of us got what we wanted. I never got a dad that says I love you. You never got redemption from betting on me and failing yourself. That's my best guess, at least. And now, it will have to do. I was never, would never be what you wanted me to be. And you were never what I wanted you to be. And now, now you love me. Because you didn't say it unless you couldn't help it. So maybe this isn't that big of a chance. It's not a change. It's just like when I left home. We won't speak or see each other. We will just have to know. And even though I really, really struggle to believe that you like it, I know I love you too.
We shall live in your kingdom?
Yes. Now I know how to live. Come with me. We have work to do.
Why now?
Because it's time.
Why did you come back just now?
What are you asking me?
Why didn't you come earlier? What haven't you been waiting for?
I waited for you to believe.
And now I do?
Now you do. Only now that you are alone, you truly believe in me.
Right. And the others?
Any that believe.
Mm-hmm. Mm. And why am I so special?
You believe.
Yeah, I get it. I believe because I'm the last one left.
Yes.
Yeah. And the others didn't believe because they couldn't, because I was the last one, right? So, why am I so special?
Aren't you glad?
What did the others do wrong? You drew slots, or how in God's name have you chosen me?
Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God.
You know what? We already are in vain. We are in the middle of the fucking vein in the goddamn desert. That's about the only thing left. Desert. So I didn't take thy name in vain. You came by yourself. So why have you chosen
me? Because you had the spark of faith, others didn't.
And that's because of me?
Of course.
Are you sure? Because I don't understand. I had the spark of faith, others didn't. Others that you've made, right? They didn't believe in you because of you.
It's more complicated than that.
Try me. Why didn't you give them faith?
I gave them the book. It's over there.
Okay. Nobody understands shit from this book.
I gave them free will. They could have decided. Faith is a choice. Otherwise, it's nothing.
How could have they believed while the tornadoes were destroying their houses and the droughts were draining their children? Where were you when the planet was burning?
The planet was burning? They burned it. They marked my earth until it couldn't bear it anymore. They marked my sky. Until it couldn't bear it anymore.
You should have stopped them.
They should have stopped by themselves.
Yes, they should.
Aiden, I'll begin a new world. A world that will believe and not destroy itself.
Why did they all have to suffer?
It doesn't matter. Now I know how to do it.
Why did you let us suffocate?
There was nothing else, nothing more I could have done. It happened as it should have. It'll be all right from now on.
I don't believe you.
You don't believe, Aiden. You begin a new earth.
How many times?
What?
How many times has this happened? I'm Aiden number what?
I know what to do this time. You have to forget what has been.
What number am I?
You wouldn't understand.
You are underestimating me again.
No, you wouldn't understand because...
Oh my. So many.
It's the last time. Now I understand it.
Don't call me like this. I don't want to be Adam.
We can change the name if you want. Nobody will know.
You know what? Beat it.
What?
Fuck off. I don't need you.
We only have each other, Aiden. Come with me.
If you call me Aiden one more time,
what?
I will kill you.
What?
Don't laugh.
You kill me?
I will.
Yeah, how? Are you serious? Okay, you play hard.
I will kill you.
Michiko didn't do it, and now he wants to kill me.
Nietzsche didn't kill, he just affirmed that Christian's dogma can no longer represent it. It is not about this. Fuck off. Fuck off, or I will kill you.
I'm God. You cannot kill me. What the fuck are you doing?
Who said I will shoot you?
Put it down.
How do you create your wonderful new world if Aiden kills himself?
Stop it.
You are scared, huh?
The gun is charged.
I know.
Put it down.
I'm the last one who believes in you, right?
Put the gun down.
Answer.
Yes, you're the last one who believes in me.
And in fact, I'm the last one, right?
Please.
Answer the fucking question.
Yes, you are the last one.
What happens if I die?
I don't know.
I'll tell you, God Almighty. You are going to fuck yourself. You will die. Stop. Finish.
Okay, you're right.
I wasn't going to do that now. Maybe in a week.
Enough.
You know, because a bullet in the head is better than dying of thirst.
Put it down.
But now that you are here to see this...
Put the gun down.
What does it say in your book? Will I put the gun down?
Enough!
Never do that again! You could have blown your brains out!
Sorry, I got cut in my brain.
The safety on, you stupid fuck! The safety on!
I know.
This stays with me.
It's okay, I'm...
This stays with me.
Okay. Yeah.
If you use the gun, we keep the safety on. It's a simple rule, what the fuck?
Yeah, dude, forgive me.
Tomorrow you be God.
Sure. Here. Bunker 3025, do you copy? We have been here for 148 days. We have supply left approximately for 5 days, Freon for 20 days. Anybody there? If you dare, please give us a sign. Over.
Nothing.
Nothing.
Okay, come on back. Welcome back. Wow, let's turn on our cameras and offer all these playwrights and these actors a big round of applause for their hard work. Thank you, thank you. I have many thoughts and questions as we launch into this talk back. Many thoughts, but we'll open it up to the room. So at this point, we invite you to turn your cameras back on. We can acknowledge you either by having you unmute, or you can write in the chat. We're happy to monitor the chat as well. So whatever works best for you. But love to have you all kick it off with any questions that you might have for playwrights who might be here, for audience, or for actors who participated. We'd love to hear from you. And anything is fair game. Process, the writing.
We have plenty, sorry, Nick, but we have plenty of actors here in the room. Please give your opinions, participate in the discussion. You can speak in Portuguese and we can translate it for you, please.
We'd love to hear from you. Perhaps to start us off, if actors, if you'd like to reflect on each of your processes, how you engaged with the words that you received, and how you felt about the work that you did. All of that is of interest to us. So please tell us a little bit about your process and the work that you were working on. Particularly engaging with those words, whether in English or if you had to translate, we'd love to hear how that goes.
Okay, I can talk a little. So first of all, I'd like to thank Paul for Paulo, actually, right? For the invite. I mean, it was an awesome experience. I participated from Fortaleza within the Northeast, and the director and the other actor, Robson, Eric was the director, and Robson were in Santa Catarina. So the challenge here was to have it work while we were so far away, and to make it seem as we were part of the same group, you know, what that we're all together. So it's for me to play God was very, very interesting. I have to put my voice a little, you know, to use a little different kind of a tone to my voice. And I think Eric did a wonderful job just, you know, working with the two of us and creating this atmosphere where we actually felt like we were in a bunker, right? So I think the work that's been done by others as well are great. I've seen Carolina and Aroldo, who I know play their parts. They did a wonderful job, as well as Paulo, who I never knew who could do like an the Latino accent. And all the others were like, they just a wonderful job. It's, you know, it's speaking another language in this kind of setting and having to perform. It's not an easy task, right? For people who act, speaking their own language is a challenge, and speak a different language it's way much more. So I think everybody is did a great job, and I think congratulations to everyone, directors, actors, playwrights, and to the whole project. I think this is a wonderful initiative, and I hope we have others in the coming years. That's it.
Thank you, Cupertino. Thank you. That's so true. And it's amazing to us to hear. It's amazing to us to hear you work in that way. So thank you. Other thoughts? Tariq, please.
Hi, everyone. I just want to say like a huge congratulations to all of you for pulling off this Herculean task, and all these was so, so wonderful to listen to and to reflect on. I had a question specifically for Simone and Valeria to ask how you guys worked together. It's such a personal, intimate story. So your process in working together, both as actor, performer, and the playwright.
I believe the playwright is here. Valeria, are you able to speak or answer any part of that question?
Simone and Laura, did you understand the question or you need translation?
Só me repete, eu não entendi qual foi a pergunta por causa do sotaque dele.
Ele tá
eu também não entendi.
Tá, ele está perguntando para vocês que as duas personagens que vocês fizeram eram personagens muito sensíveis com a história da relação delas com o pai. Então ele pergunta como que vocês se sentiram interpretando essas personagens com essa problemática que foi colocada na peça.
Simone, tu quer responder primeiro?
Pode responder, amor.
Tá bom. Bom, eu acho que primeiro para começar, assim, é realmente algo difícil, como o Cupertino já tinha trazido a questão de você ter a barreira do idioma, né? Isso já é super difícil, assim, de superar. E, enfim, a personagem em si, ela também tem muitos detalhes, né? Ela tinha a questão das vozes, ela tinha uma relação complicada com o pai, ela faz uma amizade que é um pouco confusa, aquilo não fica claro, a relação que ela tem explicitamente ali com a amiga. Eu acho que, sem dúvida, é trabalhoso, né? É um processo, assim, de você conseguir se distanciar daquilo e, ao mesmo tempo, trazer essa veracidade, né, da confusão da personagem. Eu acho que a Rowan era uma personagem, assim, bastante, eu diria, trabalhosa mesmo, porque ela tem muitas facetas, né? Ao mesmo tempo que o que vem de mal, o que vem de ruim não é ela, também é ela. Ou não, isso só a autora poderia esclarecer para a gente. Mas sim, com certeza eu achei isso bem difícil, esse contato da Rowan com o pai. Até porque a gente não entende exatamente o que acontece com a mãe dela. E sim, eu achei bastante complexo, assim, o trabalho de fazer a Rowan em cena.
So she's saying that it was a huge challenge for her because it seems that the character has multiple personalities. It was really difficult to make it differently. So young Rowan, and then she as a young woman, and then after that, the voices, because we decided that she would do the voices and not another actress. And the relationship with the friend, with Lou, is very, for her, is kind of ambiguous. She's not really sure what is going on between both of them, and also the relationship with the father. So she has to play Rowan itself is a character that has very different sides. And besides that, we decided to have Laura making the voices, and that was an extra challenge for her. And then the language barrier. She mentioned that language is also another problem because it's a foreign language, and yeah.
You handled it beautifully. It was really well handled, and that is a lot of text. So thank you.
And she's curious about meeting the playwright, but I don't know if he or she is there, right?
We had a message in the chat from Valeria. I think they're having connectivity issues, it looks like.
But Valeria is not the playwright of this, is she?
No.
I think
Quay. Oh, Valerie from Rage Laughter, right? Yeah.
Yes.
Quay joined us. Sorry, my dog is barking. Quay, I think, is the playwright for this particular piece. And
yes.
Quay joined us earlier, but might have had a connectivity issue.
Okay.
But we'll make sure that she gets the recording.
And if we also in the past have kind of brokered a conversation and questions, so if anything comes up, and maybe Paolo, you can translate this, but if anything comes up for any of the actors, anything that they're curious about, we'd be happy to pass on questions to the playwright as well for continued response.
O Nick está dizendo, eles falaram que a autora não pôde estar presente porque ela não está conseguindo se conectar, mas se vocês tiverem outras perguntas, já que ela talvez não pode participar aqui, que vocês quiserem fazer, eles repassam para ela depois, tá? Para quem leu essa peça.
Thank you. Janet.
Hi, I was wondering, Paolo, about your editing process. Do you have a separate editor, or are you doing that yourself?
I'm not able to do that. I can do many things, but I'm very bad with technology. No, thank God we have Eric. Eric is not here. He is the director of two of the plays, and at the same time, he was this time the editor. So he did everything. He is fantastic. So without him, we would not be able to present our readings. No, it was not me. It was one of our students.
Fantastic. And your decision to have the text, have subtitles, what brought you to that? That was really interesting. I really liked it. But can you talk about what brought you to that?
Sincerely, I have already had trouble understanding other non-English speakers giving the text. And then I thought that maybe it could happen with us as well, because we are not native English speakers. So I think it's better to understand when sometimes the pronunciation is not clear enough. And I think it helps to understand the play. So this is the reason. And all of them agreed with that. It was not something that they felt somehow offended or, yeah.
No, I think it was a great idea. I think it's something that I might consider in the future. It's, even with people who speak English as a first language, somehow having the text was a great reminder over this kind of visual medium that it is text that we're exploring right now. And it brought the text to the fore, and that was really nice. And one last question about your music choices and how you came up with that.
Quay's play was a very thriller oriented play, and it reminded me immediately of Hitchcock. And so I decided to explore Bernard Herrmann's music, which is fantastic. So this was the first decision. And actually we had another song, another Indian, Hindi, Hindu song at the end, because they mentioned India, right? The mother is probably in India. She left and she's living in India. But unfortunately, it didn't happen. So at the end, we would have some mantras, so songs there. And Valeria's play, so it's not clear where they are in the first scene, but it seems they are, and because of their names, they are in Latin America. So we decided someplace in between, so between Central and South America. And so we found that song, and we thought it represented really well this the place where she comes from, probably. And then in the second moment, when she is trying to solve her issues with the father, there are only sound effects, not actually music along her speech. But at the end, we decided to bring some, you know, more sweet music. And then we picked this music by Debussy. And Eric, I don't know, Eric is not here, so he made his choices. I don't know if Cupertino, Robson, Agnaldo, and Kawana, who are all here, you know about the music that Eric decided to put in your place. You know that? No? So it's going to be a secret. We don't know.
Another possible follow-up. That's really fantastic. But it was very rich, and it was not intrusive, which I really appreciated. It was actually, it was almost punctuation at times, which was really nice. I felt like it was folded very well into the textual landscape. So I really appreciated the soundscape. And Kristen put in the chat, your animation. What a wonderful choice. Can you tell us a little bit about that choice too? That was very interesting.
So when we decided to write the stage, to have the stage directions written as captions, as legends, we thought, so this first one is very long. So let's try to make something more dynamic and transform it into a visual, not word, but not literary visual thing, but an image with differently from the actors, to create another level of images. And then we decided to make the beginning with this comics.
Yeah, definitely. Tariq, I saw a hand earlier. I just wanted to come back.
Yes, I actually had a question for you, Paolo, to piggyback off something that Janet said about the subtitles. And so I'm not sure if this program, and Kristen and Nikki could probably attest to this, if there's a requirement for the plays to be performed in English. Is there a requirement for the plays to be? There is. Okay, because I was going to say if they are subtitles, then what was the choice to have non-English speakers perform in English if, you know, if they could have done it in another language? But yeah.
It's a great question. When we were thinking about the exchange years ago, we thought about what it would be like. And while we welcome translation and maybe even side by side, we have kind of set the lingua franca, so to speak, as English. And, you know, in that we recognize that so many different languages intersect in this exchange. And so it's really created both some very rich discovery and also some very real challenges that we have to acknowledge. But ultimately, yes, the request of the exchange is that we do perform in English. But we've also thought about, and I'd be curious to see what the group thinks, we've also thought about what it would be to see both, even just one play in both. What would it be to see it translated? That's such a critical facet of what we do anyway, translation, and we have had some translations in the past. So I wonder what that would be like, and I wonder what the group thinks of that.
Did the Brazilians understand his question? No?
Okay, go ahead.
I'm just going to translate if so someone else would like to answer that. O Nick está perguntando como seria se vocês fizessem em português o texto e tivesse legenda em inglês, se vocês acham que seria mais interessante ou não.
Carolina, yeah.
Para mim, a maior dificuldade realmente foi a linguagem, né? O inglês. Mas acredito que se eu tivesse falando em português, minha língua, o desempenho talvez fosse um pouco melhor, mais solto, mais possuída pelo personagem, não é? Acho que é isso, Paulo.
O Pertino traduz para nós, teu inglês é melhor que o meu.
Ok. So, Carolina is saying that if she had the opportunity to perform in Portuguese, speaking Portuguese, her performance would be probably better, because she would be more comfortable, you know, so she wouldn't have to be concerned about the language itself. Her concern would be about the performance. And that's her thought. I'm going to give my own opinion now, you know, if possible. Well, I do think that as an opportunity for engagement of different nations and different groups, and, you know, and different students and playwrights and actors from different parts of the world, I think it's a great opportunity to actually perform in English as a way to interact, as a way to connect, and as a way to put ourselves out there, right? Because language is a barrier. Yes, of course we do know. But we also see international, I saw here the performances tonight, like I was seeing, some international movies, the way we go to the movies, and we see sometimes people speaking in English with a thick accent, and the performance is there. So I could see here, I mean, some great performances like the one that Laura gave, which is, she was scary, as I actually put in the chat. And I think once we pass that self-consciousness about the accent and about speaking the language, fully or in the most beautiful way, once we pass that, it's all performance. It's all the same. So I think yes, it would be easier for everybody to speak in Portuguese. But I think for the challenge of the whole project, make sense to me that we keep English as language. So
thank you for that perspective. Absolutely.
O Per, pode me ajudar mais uma coisinha que eu queria dizer? Então, o que para mim ficou muito claro também nesse trabalho, pela dificuldade da língua que eu tive que superar, além da atuação, foi a necessidade de uma profunda ligação com os meus pares e com o diretor, para poder todo mundo fazer essa superação. Então, para mim, fica super claro que, na verdade, a língua é uma barreira? É, sim. Mas se a gente tiver um grupo com uma direção firme, como foi a do Paulo, firme no sentido de bem encaixada, bem entrosada, com certeza que o trabalho é possível. Obrigada, Cooper.
Ok, so Carolina is saying that although the challenge, the language barrier, you know, is a challenge, there is a deeper challenge, which is to make everything work together. As people are in different sets, in different cities, and so making a connection, making it happen, is the biggest challenge. So once that is achieved, the other challenge is even the language. It's a smaller challenge. So she believes, and I agree with it, I believe everyone agrees, that having someone like Paulo, be the master, you know, creating this environment of a collaboration between actors, playwrights, and directors, and creating this deep connection between everyone, among everyone. That was the key to, you know, to making this thing, you know, happen and making it nice, you know, to be presentable, which was, I believe, the main goal of Paulo's, you know, that, you know, as he was talking to everybody, to make it, no, let's do a good job. That's, and I think the end result, you know, speaks for itself.
And that it does. And it serves the mission so well. I think that our global partners really understand the mission, and certainly Paulo deeply understands the mission, to connect playwrights and audiences from worlds apart. And it's an opportunity for these playwrights to hear their words. Doesn't necessarily mean that they grasp every word, but they absolutely feel their meaning. And that's really impactful. So thank you. I think that's really well said. Thank you so much. Other thoughts or questions? Other impressions? We have time for a couple more. I'll just say briefly, I really appreciated some of the cinematic choices that I saw. I saw a lot of inspiration, I think, and from, I certainly saw maybe some film noir. I certainly saw maybe some absurdism creeping in here and there. But what I really appreciated was that the words were centered and we could hear them so well. So the stories, while brilliantly directed and designed, were also really well executed. And I really would like to compliment the actors, and Paulo, if you would be so kind as to translate this, or Cooper, the characterizations were so strong that even if a word was missing or a sound was different or an accent is there, the characterizations carried the language, because we read so much more than text when we're listening to a story. And I think that was really, really beautiful. So I just wanted to thank you for elevating those words quite stylistically, but also beautiful, also clearly.
Vai, Cooper.
Vai que é tu, Paulo, porque o mérito é todo teu. Eu acho que na escolha, okay. So Paulo asked me to speak again. So I think that the choices made, I think it's also, so first, he's actually saying that so I need to translate to Portuguese, actually. So ele está dizendo que ficou muito impressionado com a performance, né? Com a performance dos atores. Com a atmosfera criada, né? Que foi uma atmosfera criada de filme noir, né? De thriller, né? Que todo o ambiance que foi feito nas apresentações, deu uma ficou um visual muito interessante. Então, mesmo que alguma palavra aqui ou ali tenha sido pronunciada de uma maneira diferente, com um sotaque mais forte, que tal, mas o todo, né, foi percebido, porque a interpretação foi muito boa, a cena foi muito bem dirigida e toda a ambiência da cena estava lá. E isso a gente sabe que foi um trabalho, né, conjunto dos nossos diretores, do Paulo e tal. Então, eu acho que é isso. Né? Acho que foi isso, né, Paulo, que ele falou. Acho que foi basicamente isso.
Sim, ele destacou a importância que a gente dá para a palavra, que mesmo que tenha tido música, que tenha tido outros efeitos, a história em quadrinhos, que a gente deu uma ênfase muito grande para a palavra. And it's really interesting you mentioned that, Nick, because here in Brazil we have a huge prejudice against spoken theater. Because of the culture we have here that's very physical and very body oriented, because of the cultural formation of the country and because of the very low level of literacy, people culturally, historically, they tended to enjoy more other kinds of artistic expressions than literary art. And for this reason, in theater, there is a preference for physical theater or improvisational theater or body-centered theater. And then spoken theater is seen as something old and old-fashioned and conservative and sometimes even authoritarian. Sure. But here in our study group, we try to show that this is a prejudice because you can do spoken theater without being prejudicial or conservative or old-fashioned. You can explore contemporary issues and forms and join with the word and not necessarily be something only an entertainment theater or commercial theater or old-fashioned theater. So thank you for your words. It's very important for us.
Absolutely. It's amazing to hear. And I would just tack on before I step back out of the speaking role and into the moderating, that I would say that I heard the words in part because of how embodied they were. They were so resonant, and coming from my own perspective as a vocalist, I appreciated where they were placed in the voice because they were deeply rooted in the body. And I genuinely believe that the voice is the embodiment of the imagination. So to actually see that, I would argue this was embodied literary theater, very embodied and very beautiful. So thank you. Thank you very much. Kristen, put something in the chat that I also think is interesting in terms of process. She said the playwrights have given clues and like to hear about how you interpreted those clues so effectively since you created such distinctive worlds for each play.
A pergunta para vocês e pelo amor de Deus, se manifestem, gente, principalmente quem ainda não se manifestou em português, que eu e o Cupertino a gente traduz, eles querem saber como que vocês interpretaram, como vocês entenderam os textos e os papéis que vocês ganharam a partir das dicas que estavam sendo dadas pelas autoras dos textos, pelos universos que elas criaram, para fazer os papéis de vocês.
I can start by, can you hear me?
Uh-huh, perfect.
Okay, so I personally love the apocalyptical theme, and I think that my play was perfect for me. You guys are talking about voice, and I would like to congratulate my partner, Sean Cooper. He has a wonderful voice, and for me it was like a privilege to have this experience and act with this magical voice, you know, that he brings to the scene. I think it was amazing. I really felt like I was talking to God. So I would like also to say it's not a part of the answer, but I think that in this particular play, this text, I felt a little bit disappointed by with the end, how it ends, because I'm also a playwright, so I cannot like just think as an actor. So thinking as a playwright, I think that it ends a little bit like the author was enganando a gente. Please, guys, help me. Fooling.
Yeah, fooling. Fooling. The playwright fooled us without thinking. Yeah. Thinking that was something in it. At the end, it's something else. So he didn't like that end. Me neither.
yeah. So the dialogue was very well produced. I mean, like the aura, the atmosphere, you know, it's so well done. And then at the end, it was like it was all a role play. So I felt that if maybe the author explore more the this God thing would be very, very much better. But it's a personal impression. So that's it.
Janet.
Just as a contrary opinion, I really liked that the God was actually us. You know, when we think about the history of the writing of the Bible, it was written by humans. And so that we are playing God, I thought was a wonderful reveal. We're talking to ourselves. And I also particularly liked, which it's not in relationship to what you said, was the notion of changing roles. Okay, you play this person this tomorrow. I thought that was really intriguing, and it just gave me a little window into their lives. You know, 5 days of food left after so much time alone, and the radio at the end. I think it was, you know, what do we do when we're desperate? You know, as I consider myself an agnostic, but when times are very hard, I involuntarily say, oh, please, God, oh, please. And I'm thinking, where is that coming from? It's so I've internalized the kind of Christianity that I consciously don't agree with, but it's there. So I found it really interesting.
And what about the size of the Bible when they show the book?
Yeah.
Another thing, what I really thought it was great is the dialogue, you know, was very tense, was very well written. So for me, what I was trying to say is that it seems like, okay, I really wanted to see how this would end if it really was God in there. So, but it's not that I think it's a bad way to end the text, but I was just curious, you know.
It's funny. I love the gun. I love that this time it was loaded. We're getting close to the end of our food, but we don't load the gun when we do this. I love the breakdown of order. There's something really fun in that, and also very dangerous. Other thoughts? Kristen, please.
I just wanted to add that one of the supplies that's running out is water. And that seemed like a really clever way to tuck in the theme.
Definitely. A time consideration applied to water. It's really cool. We have time for probably one more. Any other thoughts, observations? Such a vibrant discussion. Thank you so much. Simone.
Hello. I'm sorry because I didn't answer Tariq's question before the beginning. Actually, as we thought here that we are each one at one house, I think that helped me, Tariq, to work on this not so close relationship with that she has. So I think that helped us on working on it. And at the first part, we decide not to show the audience all that, just make, and then for the monologue of hers, so you can understand that they are not aren't that close to. But I think it helped us to be each one in a different place. Sorry, it takes that time to answer you.
No, thank you. Thank you. And you did a wonderful job, everyone. It was just fantastic.
Thank you.
That makes great sense, Simon. Thank you. And we find that, Kristen put it in the chat as well, that sometimes the physical distance can be a useful tool. Yeah. Great. Any final thoughts as we come to our closing?
Well done, everybody. I was really engaged the entire time. So thank you. Thank you for the work you've put into lifting the words of these texts off of the page.
Absolutely. Thank you all. It's really wonderful. And so with that, we'll conclude. As always, we thank you for joining us. This is about us, this no cost, no travel theater that we hold here. And so we're really grateful. Just a reminder that we will see all of you one more time for University of Toronto's reading. It is tomorrow at 12 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, so EDT. And we've included the time converter in our email for each of you, depending on where you are time zone wise. But we will conclude with that reading, and that'll wrap up the exchange for this year. So thank you. In the meantime, thank you, Paolo, for this wonderful evening of theater. And we look forward to seeing you, Janet, tomorrow and your students' work. Thank you for continuing to support this exchange and helping us to connect playwrights and audiences from worlds apart. Continued thanks to George Mason University School of Theater, our Dean Rick Davis, our director Jola Branner, and all past directors for their support and for making this program continually possible. Thank you all. Have a wonderful evening and hope to see you tomorrow. Good night.
Ciao, todo mundo.
Ciao. Obrigado.
Ciao.
Bye-bye.